very little about how useful this information will be, but here's what I decided to focus on for today. I'll tell you three brief stories, and the first one has to do with how did I get into Ionia Prison under my own power, and it's not get thrown there and thrown away for a decade. The first group of students from the Calvin Prison Initiative had gone through a year of study, and those students, especially the ones who considered themselves writers, went to a couple of people I know, and they said, we've got a request. What we want is a non-credit course, because we can't add any more to the curriculum. We wouldn't be able to schedule it. But we have learned so much about what we need to do with our sentences, our phrases and clauses in the writing classes, that we really want an upper level grammar course so that we know the names of things. As we work on our revision, as we work on our new writing, it would be so much better for us as writers to know what to call things. Is there anyone at Calvin College who could present an upper level traditional grammar review so we can learn what to call things? As soon as I heard that, I thought, if that isn't God calling my name, I've lost all of my senses. And so I said, of course I'll do it. I know the text about what you have done to the least of these you have done to me. I couldn't turn away and say, they must need someone else. So of course I went. That's the one quick, easy story. And then going in, I mainly was focusing on what teachers focus on all the time. What's the sort of material these students really need? How can I help them make sure they have some basic control of it, maybe move into mastery? And what kinds of skills will be portable skills that they won't need me there to be able to put into work in the rest of their lives as students and beyond? Those are my concerns. What can I teach them, and mainly instrumental stuff? How can I make sure that what I've done in the classroom there turns into something they can actually use and use for a long time and use for a lot of other people's advantage as well? So I was thinking mainly, how can I do this job well? And I did all the work that I could to prepare for it, and I went there and started teaching, made on the first day what my colleague who taught the course with me said was a rookie mistake. I said to the students the first night, we're going to be here for 2 hours from 7 to 9 every Tuesday night. 2 hours, I know from all my years of teaching, is a long, long time for students to pay attention. And so would you like to take a short break between, oh, say right around 8 o'clock? So we have a few minutes to get up, move around, and then get back to work again. And to a person, they all looked mystified by that question. And I thought, I wonder if I just said something wrong. And an angry-looking man in the back row put his hand up, Professor Vandenbosch. He said, well, we thought maybe you're kidding. We all have time. All we have here is time. What we want is teaching. There will be no breaks for 2 hours. And I thought, I have landed in a teacher's paradise. this is just an amazing, and this was the first revelatory moment for me. And I kept having new things taught to me every time I taught there, all the way through the spring term of 2017. So I went worrying about how am I going to get this teaching done so that they profit the most from it. And what I ended up finding out is that I was learning more from them almost every week than they were probably learning from me. And so that's really, if you need a basic theme for these two stories I'm going to tell you about the students I worked with, it is be ready to have revelations come your way, instead of assuming that what you're mainly doing is providing information for people who don't have any. They have a lot of wisdom already, it turns out, and they had it before they got to prison, but they have never been taken seriously very long. And you take people seriously and remarkable things begin to happen. I've often told my student teachers, if you wait around for interesting people, you can wait for a long time. If you find everyone you meet interesting, you've solved that problem. And everyone you meet is interesting. You just need to have time, you need to be able to be with them in ways that allow you to see how interesting they are. So I had come with all that preaching of mine to my students in the background, still not ready to be taught by my students in the Calvin Prison Initiative. So the two texts, the one that I've mentioned already very briefly from Matthew 25, ends this way, I was in prison and you came to visit me. That was the kind of gospel in the background that I thought I needed to hear, and so of course I said, yes, I'll do it. But there's another one from Hebrews 13 that came to be, over the term of the semester, more and more obviously aimed at me. And if you don't know this text already, you'll remember it as soon as I mention it. Hebrews 13, 1 through 3, keep on loving one another as brothers and sisters. Do not forget to show hospitality to strangers, for by so doing, some people have shown hospitality to angels without knowing it. Continue to remember those in prison as if you were together with them in prison, and those who are mistreated as if you yourselves were suffering. Later, that text was clearly the text I should have been paying attention to the entire term I was there with them. Two quick stories. One about a man I'll just refer to as Brian. Sort of an angry-looking man. He made me a little uneasy the first couple of weeks I was there to meet him, but he's got an angry look and a gentle, sweet heart. And it's just a look he's perfected over the years, but a wonderful, sweet man. And here's my interaction with him in the shortest form I can give it. There's a whole lot more drama in the background, all kinds of side drama and other stories related to it. But you may remember last spring in March, not this spring, but last spring in March, a Calvin student, Tara Oscom, was killed in a terrible wreck a little bit further south from here yet. She was my student last spring, was my student also the previous spring. And just getting over the fact that one of my students had died took all the energy I had those first few weeks after she was killed. She sat up in the front row of the second row from the end, and all I could do whenever I met that class was notice that empty seat. You know what I'm talking about. And the next Tuesday when I went to class out in Hanlon Prison, Bryant walked up to me at the very beginning of class before it began. He said, Professor Vandenbosch, have you heard about that Calvin student who was killed in that terrible accident? Oh, I said, Brian, she's one of my students. We're just heartbroken at Calvin. I can't look at that empty seat with almost weeping in class. I'm not good for it here either right now. And he said, we want to send her a card. We make cards here in the prison. Our real artist just got transferred to Marquette, so he said, I'm the second string artist, and I'll be making a card. Could you do us all a favor and take this card out of the prison when we're finished with it and deliver it to the Oscom family? I said, did you know Ms. Oscom? No, no, no. And he said, no, you don't understand me. We're Calvin students. She's a Calvin student. We need to mourn with the other Calvin students and let the family know how much we love them. Again, as raw as the feelings were for Tara Oscom, here's this big, angry, hulking man telling me this, and I nearly weep there at the prison initiative, and weeping to start the class is not for me the best pedagogical technique. Just as weeping in a chapel service, not a good idea for me. So I said, of course, and I talked to people, made sure I could do this without being wrestled to the floor by guards and not being let out of Ionia prison myself. And a couple of weeks later, I was given the card and I delivered it, and all kinds of good things happened because of that card. And then a couple of weeks after that, he pulled me aside at a break during the day, not a real break, but a break because we were doing some change of activities. He said, so how has it all gone with the Tara Oscom Memorial Service at the college and all of that? I said, well, you know, for all the grief and loss, everything went as well as we could be expected to be able to manage things. And I said to him, because by this time it was natural enough, normal enough just to talk to him, like another student. And from that point on, he was just another student to me, but a very interesting one. I said, you know, Brian, I've thought over the years that these losses would be easier and easier to take. Whether it's someone in the family, a neighbor, a friend, a student, I said, the students have always been hard to let go. And he said the most remarkable thing to me, and I said, but it's not easier. I wish it would get easier, but it hasn't got easier. Still heartbroken for weeks and months at a time. He said, Professor Vandenbosch, never wish to be hard-hearted. He said, never wish for it. I see it in people every day here at the prison. They think they've got to be a hard, hard person all the time or they'll be destroyed here. And then after a while, they don't know how to be anything else. Never wish for a harder prisoner is now teaching me and teaching me things that I, of course, know, but who would expect those words from one of my prison students in Hamlet? So there, the story of Brian is one of those ongoing revelations to me. I think about him often. I've got pictures in my file here so I can smile in his direction every now and then. It is just for me a wonderful, wonderful teaching ministry that he's doing to the Calvin professors who come to teach him. Never wish for a harder heart. That's just really good advice in general. The other story has to do with a man who's not in the program. He keeps applying to the program and never gets accepted because he's such a big, noisy guy and is constantly taking charge, and he wants to preach at people all the time, so his nickname in the prison is the Bishop. A wonderful man too, but full of confidence that he shouldn't always have. And I know a lot of people like that, people who don't have as much, don't have the sense of where they need to let their confidence, say, take a back seat for a while. But here's what began to happen, and I'll tell you the background story a little bit. I've written this up for a blog that's put out by Perspectives, a Reformed magazine, and if JR wants this, I'll make sure he gets a copy of it. But the thing that happened at the very beginning of the day every day would be about anywhere between 20 and 30 minutes of students asking grammar questions. So we had to get used to that. The students would ask more questions and better questions than the corresponding course I was teaching at the college. And I would go back for the first few weeks on Wednesday to say, you can't believe the questions I got last night. These people are starting to make you look bad. I'm trying to encourage them to ask better questions at Calvin College. The third time I mentioned it, I was getting angry looks in the classroom, so I never mentioned it again. But it was one of those remarkable things. We'd begin the hour with 20 to 30 questions. But before that happened, my teaching partner, Andrew Zwart, said, Jim, we've given them a sign-up sheet so they can do opening devotions. And they've all signed up. Almost everyone in the room signed up for one of the available 13 or 14 days. And so I'll read you a little bit about what happened on some of those first things that happened with the teaching that was going on with the devotions that they had all through the opening minutes of the class. On the first evening, the student read Paul's great chapter on love, 1 Corinthians 13, and he read it from his King James Bible. As he read those ringing words, I listened to them more carefully than I had in years. We all know that chapter so well, we don't even hear it. To hear it said by a big African-American man, not the bishop, but another man, and to read with conviction all the way through, was one of those, again, remarkable experiences. You hear the gospel and every part of the scripture story different when you hear it read by a person in prison. It suddenly means different things than it had meant before. On another night, a student read a very brief text about keeping guard over our mouths and thus guarding our souls, and he prayed a simple prayer asking for a blessing on our grammar work in the coming hours. This was not a warning to me to guard my tongue, but he wanted them all to behave as if they were in the presence of nothing but Christians and guarding their own talk and guarding their own comments so that everyone would be edified by the way a grammar class went. These things just kept coming all the time. I was, after a while, paying so much attention to the students at the beginning of the hour that I sort of forgot what I was there to do that night, because those opening devotions by the students were just so startling. And then the bishop came up, third or fourth Tuesday, I think, that we taught there. He took his turn and preached on John 11, focusing on this verse from the Lazarus story. And here's the text. This sickness, Jesus said, this is way back in verse 3, before they even go out and find the dead man. Jesus said to his disciples, this sickness is not unto death. This sickness is not unto death, but for the glory of God, that the Son of God might be glorified thereby. And then he stood up, and this is a man who is accustomed to doing a lot of preaching, I can tell. And that's why they call him the bishop, but also probably why they won't let him in the program so far. He needs to learn how to tone it down a little bit, dial it back, not be the boss in the room, but another student, and that's really hard for him. And he turned around and looked at all of us, and I was sitting right about there where Maria is sitting up in the front row, just watching again with amazement. He said, "This is our text for tonight. This is not about sickness unto death. This prison," he says, "and our incarceration here is not about death. It is instead about resurrection and glorifying God."
Amen.
And I don't know how many of you know a little bit of black English, but instead of saying, "I'm going to do something," or "I'm gonna," "I'm fixing to do something" is a southern version of that, and it gets turned into black English into finna. And here's the way he preached it. And he started looking around the audience for people to point at as he was saying it. He said it several times, and one of them, he turned right at me and pointed his finger at me. And he said, and he began to proclaim even more emphatically, "This sickness is not unto death." And this is, I wrote it down afterwards so I wouldn't forget it. God finna work a resurrection in someone. God's going to work a resurrection in someone in this room. He finna do a work of resurrection, and it will be for the glory of God. God going to work a work of resurrection in you, he said to me. And it was like electricity has gone through my entire system, and I was slain by the Spirit in the front row of a grammar class by the bishop preaching from a text from John. Now, I think it's true what he's saying. We all need that work of resurrection. It's not just the inmates of the prison in the Calvin Prison Initiative or those who are trying desperately to be part of that cohort. It's not just them. All of us, God is finna work a resurrection in you. It's personal and it's individual and it's not just abstract. The bishop that night preached at me and at Andrew as well as everyone else in the room, and he made everyone pay attention. What is God doing to you, with you, and through you right here, tonight, in this grammar class? Again, I went home thinking I had been more blessed by the students in that program than the students were likely to be blessed by me. And I think I learned something very, very basic that night, very basic, and that is, you always learn from students. I've been preaching and teaching that for years and years because I helped supervise student teachers for a long time at Calvin. And so I know it. I didn't expect it at Handlin. I was so focused on what I was going to be able to contribute and productively focused on what I was going to be able to contribute to them. I had almost no anticipation of what I was going to learn from them. And so I guess instead of focusing only, what am I giving to these people that they need? An excellent focus. Every interaction probably is an opportunity for you to learn as well, and probably to learn from people you would never expect to have the credentials to teach you anything. This has been a very, very good experience for me. I don't know when the next time I can do it might happen. I've been going to school in September for 65 years in a row. It's time for me to take a break from that kind of schedule in September. Maybe I should just stay home once, see what it's like. But since I was 4, I've been heading off in September, and so now I'm a little cautious about making 13-week commitments to teach. But if I get a chance to go there again, once I get over this need not to have 13-week schedules superimposed on my life every year, I may be back there again. It is that rewarding. So, bless you all in the work you do. It really does make a difference in those lives. And if you do have the opportunity, directly or indirectly, to be actually in communication with these students, you'll probably learn the sort of thing I learned and shouldn't have had to learn, and that is how much they may have to teach you. Never wish for a harder heart. God finna do a work of resurrection in you. I heard it authoritatively there, and I believe it's true. Thank you.
Amen. Exactly what I wanted to say. Thank you so much. Let's just let's close with prayer. Lord, thank you for this day, for our guest, for words that we needed to hear, particularly those who are in this work every day. students. We thank you for our mentors. We thank you for our volunteers who are willing to enter into this work. We pray for our hearts that will be willing to have work done on us as well as what we can offer to our students. We give you this day, give you all the praise and the glory, and everyone in the room agreed and said,
Amen.
So I have a opportunity for you, Professor Jim, just in case. I showed Jim downstairs the volume of work we have to do here. If you guys haven't seen the lessons that are over by the packet desk, have someone show you how many lessons there are to be sent to students. It's an overwhelming number right now. We have students waiting for mentors, people. They're waiting. Tell your friends. Find someone to help with this work. If you have one student, take another one. We need people to help us with this work. We have lessons that are sitting there, and every one of those is representative of a student who's desperate for that word and that piece of hope. So we don't operate on a 13-week calendar. We will operate on your calendar. We'll send it to your house. You can do it in your on your front porch with your bunny slippers on in the morning while you're watching everyone else go to school. So that's just a pitch. Okay. All right, so everyone has a reading by their chair. Let's just close with this benediction. I'll read the first one, and we'll all read together, et cetera, as we go through. Rise up, shine, for my glory rises on you. I, the Lord, have called you. I will hold your hand. I will redeem you, and I will make you a symbol of promise for my precious people.
I have put my spirit on you and enabled you to share good news with the poor. I have sent you to free the captives, release the prisoners from darkness, and to heal broken hearts.
I bestow beauty for ashes, gladness for mourning, and I turn despair into praise.
When you spend yourselves on behalf of the hungry and satisfy the needs of the oppressed, then you will become a light in the dark places, and your night will shine like the new day.
I will guide you, satisfy you, and strengthen you. You will repair devastated places and restore the paths that lead to home for those who are wandering.
Every valley will be raised, and every mountain will be made low, and my glory will be revealed, and together all of my children will see it.
I, the Lord, love justice. Instead of shame, everlasting joy will be theirs,